President, this is my first or maiden speech in this Parliament. As a UKIP East of England MEP, you'll expect me to be a rebel, and I'll try not to disappoint you or my voters. Mr. President, we're discussing today EU trade agreements, and in particular that of South Korea, due to be signed this year. As we do not have much of the detail on this particular agreement, other than the fact I believe that two-thirds of the benefits will accrue to South Korea and a third to the EU, I'd like to make some more general points. Many people are not aware that there are over 100 separate bilateral EU trade agreements like this one. 116 is one estimate. There are trade agreements with countries such as the USA, Canada, Mexico, Brazil, India, China, Japan, and South Africa. In Europe, there are trade agreements with Russia, Ukraine, Turkey, and Liechtenstein. There are trade agreements also with non-EU, EEA, and EFTA countries such as Switzerland and Norway. Norway's trade agreement religiously protects both its fishing and farming. And Norway is not a minnow. It is the EU's fourth largest import partner and the sixth largest export market. What should a trade agreement like South Korea's really contain then? Switzerland, I believe, is a strong example. There are provisions abolishing custom duties and trade quotas on industrial and agricultural products. There are provisions to allow Swiss citizens the right to live and work in EU countries, and for EU citizens to live and work in Switzerland. There are provisions for Switzerland to be part of the Schengen passport-free area. The Swiss can be in the European Environment Agency, if they wish, the EU's film and education programs, and they can apply for EU research grants. There's cooperation on airlines, on asylum, and on judicial matters. In short, they have all the claimed benefits of EU membership, but without the costs. Now, it is true, Switzerland must pay 600 million Swiss francs a year for access, but the Swiss government reports savings for not being a member of the EU, amounting to 3.4 billion Swiss francs, a net saving of 2.8 billion francs a year. Nor is Switzerland an insignificant trading partner either. 80% of Swiss exports go to the EU, and it is the EU's fourth largest trading partner. My point, Mr. President, is that trade agreements can achieve the benefits of EU trade without the burden of high regulatory costs, loss of sovereignty, and of resources. Even the Commission website admits, quote, Switzerland can develop
Mr.
and
Campbell
retain...
Mr. Bannerman, can I interrupt you? Because we have the blue card procedure.
Yes.
So I give the word to Mr. Gaspari.
Well, sorry, what is the blue card procedure, sir? I'm a new MEP. What is the blue card procedure?
Blue card procedure is a new procedure when any member can ask to the
could
speaker
I finish my speech
can
sir, and then be interrupted? Is that possible? I'd just like to finish. I've got one more
according to
that
rules, you have to agree to that. You have to agree. If you don't agree, that's up to you.
I'll finish my time, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
If I can just repeat that. Switzerland can develop and retain its own regulations in other areas which deviate from EU rulings. It is in its own interests, such as in financial and in labour markets. Now, how Britain would love to deviate in a similar way over the Working Time Directive, Temporary Workers Directive, or the new Fund Managers Directive. So I conclude, Mr. President, in asking, why not Britain? Why can't Britain have a similar friendly trade agreement with the EU, like South Korea, instead of full EU membership? Britain on its own is the largest single trading partner with the EU, with a £40 billion deficit a year. And we too can have the kind of assurances the Swiss enjoy. But we could, and I believe we should, be an independent, free trading nation once again, such as Norway, Switzerland, and, well, even South Korea. Thank you.